Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Visible.
Okay. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I am Nagen Kuswa, and I will talk about the design of clamping system in today's discussion. So, let me check live on YouTube or not. Yes, I am live. So, as we have seen in earlier discussion, that there are two types of clamping system. First one was common and second one was quick acting type. So we have completed the common types. We have completed this part and we will talk about the quick acting type. So let's have a revision. In a screw operated, you can see the screw with the a knob, and here again this clamp bar is tightly held against this screw and with this screw. So main function is this one is as a fulcrum, you can understand, and this one is as a raising this end up or down. If it will raise, this clamp, this end will come downward, it will. So another method from side, these are the various methods to clamp from the sides so that you can work in the workpiece from the top, you can do your work. Then this was swing plate. This one is swinging in vertical plane, and this one is swinging in horizontal plane. What we need to do, we need to take out this part, this pin out, and we can swing this plate, this part. This is the clamping bar. So we can take out, and in horizontal plane we can swing it. Then we also talked about the conventional clamping method, drilling and milling vices we have seen. And then magnetic chuck we have seen also. Then chuck and collets we have seen. This chuck, dead center end, and then collets, self-centered, two half, self-centered. Then quick clamping, here we have the quick clamping. So first one is quick acting nut. As you can see in quick acting nut, we have prepared our nut in this way. Half side, this half side, half of the portion it is having a thread, and other half it is tapered, and remaining half, you can take it two part. One is this half, half taper. It means half taper means considered as inside part, circular. So take half. This side it is having thread, and this side smooth surface. Let me zoom it, you can visualize it. And remaining side, this side, after half part, this side same procedure, other half taper and smooth, and lower part threaded. So it is termed as quick acting nut. Now you can see in this, let me further, you can see this one is smooth surface, and here you can see the threaded part. Okay, I will show you a video here how does it work. Let me explain it before showing that video. So what we do here, First, we insert the part. In taper way, this quick acting nut, we insert the in this taper, because this side is flat, this side is having thread, so we will insert it in taper way, this way, and then we turn it this way upside, and then we will lock it, then we will lock it, and then to remove it, again what we have to do, we have to unlock it first, and then we have to taper it, and then we will take it out. Let me show you a video here. So here it is. Now I hope this PPT is visible on your screen. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So now see. Workpiece, another workpiece. Then we have inserted the screw, and after that, this one, see this top. We have tilted it, inserted it, then straight and screwed. To remove it, it is locked now. Let me play it again. Now this one is stud, washer, and quick acting nut. See, I am pausing here. See, you can see this one is having a taper shape. And here half part, this only half, this side is having thread and other side is smooth, and this side having thread, other side, this side is smooth. So we will tilt it, insert it, tilt it, and then straight. Yes, okay, and then we will tilt it, then rotate. It is locked. Again, in the reverse, to unlock it, we have to first rotate it and then tilt it, take it out. Okay, I hope it is clear. So I hope you have got the understanding of this quick acting nut. Next is, we have cam clamp. So cam clamp having the advantage of the, we use the advantage of cam, that is slight eccentricity with the axis. So as you can see, we have to hold this workpiece this side. And then we have this clamp bar, and then we have this mechanism, locking mechanism, that will work as a fulcrum. And here what we have, to press the locking end of the clamp. What we have to do, we have this arrangement here and it is having the cam shape. So as you can see at the flat, this distance is minimum, so it is not raising this end. But as soon as you raise the part handle, you turn the handle, it will raise the, due to eccentricity, this axis and this axis, because the cam is generally having you can consider this way. Suppose this one is center. So once you move from this distance to this distance, it will obviously you will get some raising, and due to changing the axis of the handle or this one, this mechanism, a clamp bar where it has been clamped, it will raise the clamp bar upward and this side will go downward. So slide, we are able to get the locking force here. We can understand it more easily in this way, in this diagram. But how we can achieve this? First, we have this spring system, and here you can see one end here, it has been locked. Now see, this one having a small distance, this one having bigger distance, and this one having even bigger distance. So to lock it, first it is open, and how to make this end go downward so that it can press the workpiece. To make downward, what we have to do is simply turn the handle, and due to change in height, see this one is in free position, but as you rotate the handle, this part will come and this part will press the clamp bar downward and your piece is locked. Since it cannot go this direction, so only one direction left to go this way, and this end will go. And again, to unlock it, we simply turn the handle and this spring system will force out this clamp bar and workpiece is free to take out. I will explain in coming slide more. Again, you can see the same. Due to this, part is locked, and this one it is directly on the workpiece. And another, you can see here again, clamping bar we have, and this pushing mechanism, and here spring system we have. So this clamping end, we need to lock the workpiece, that is workpiece this side. So first we will set the position, and then we will after setting the position, and here it we have again two half nut. So first we will set the position, and after setting the position, we will with this knob we will lock it so that we have already pressed this part, this direction, this end. We have already pressed this in this direction. So our next task is to lock from the top downward, and we are doing it with the two locking nut. So one is screw here and one is screw mechanism here, and again spring, when we have to unlock it, just we have to turn take out, loose the nut, and then spring mechanism force the clamp bar to go upward and part is free. So as you can see, let me show you another video. Let me check whether I have video or not. Yes, I have. Now see this clamping ring, what we have here, this end where spring loaded, oh this one fixed pin, and then here we have spring loaded and workpiece and fixed end, and here cam mechanism. So let me play it. See, it is free position. Watch here. When we take it out, here it is placing against here. See this, there is a solder on this screw, so it is placing the that solder part, and that solder part placing the this clamp bar. Watch it carefully. As soon as since there is a difference between center to this end and here, there is a difference in height or distance. So once you move from here to here, it is compressing the this shoulder part. We can consider it as a bush. It is compressing, and bush is compressing this workpiece clamp bar, and clamp bar compressing the pressing the workpiece. Watch it again carefully. See, you can see the clamp end when lever goes down. When lever goes down, the clamp end also goes down. I hope it is clear now. So back to discussion. So now I hope you have understand the working of clamping mechanism with the cam. So there are other types of cam. You can see hinge cap. As you can see here, we have this one eye bolt here. Here this part is eye bolt. So what we can do? We have to simply take out this, open loose the nut, or simply take out, and we are able to take the this clamping bar this direction. Again, spring type, spring forces the clamp. So here this one is considered as a heel, and whole setup is considered as a heel clamp. What we have to do? We have to simply lock the screw or unlock the screw for locking the part, fixing the part. Then again, we have this sliding cam. So this one is a heel pin slot. Here what we have to do? To lock or unlock it, what we have simply just shift this position and it will lock part. Again, this type of arrangement we have, there are two pins. We can take out the pins in this way and our clamping bar is free. Then other types of clamp, loose guided. As you can see here, this one is pin and here is loose guided. Loose guided heel clamp. This one is loose guided heel, and here simply turn or take this out this way. We can move the part and clamp using heel in casting. So as you can see, the heel in the casting can be used, changing the position, and you can learn more here. A detailed discussion on all this given. So again, this mechanism, I think I have discussed this one. In this, you can see in locking, we have one end with the screw. We will press this one, change the height, not press, change the height, so that here clamping bar is also having the thread, and this one screw is also having the thread. So by just rotating the screw head or knurl head, we can say, you can understand, knurl head, we can change the respective position, because due to thread, either of one will move or down, there would be relative motion, and so that change in height, and that change in height will cause to press the clamp bar against the workpiece. Again, another type, hinge clamp. As you can see, this one is hinge, and hinge is having in this shape. So there are two ways. First, we have to loose it a bit, and then we will take it vertically in the vertical plane. We will take it downward direction. Like suppose it is, you can see the screen, and it is this one, this screw you are taking towards your face. So simply, so there are two motion, one this vertical plane motion, and then you will take this, see here, this part, this gap, you have fixed this clamp, not clamp, screw. So from here you have taken out the screw in vertical plane, and then in horizontal plane you can rotate it so that your workpiece is free. This one is your workpiece, your work is free. So two rotation, one is vertical plane of this, here you can sliding, see the sliding setup, it will slide, and then here again in horizontal plane clamp bar. Again, you can see the pivoted two-way clamp, here one-way clamping and another-way clamping, you can see threaded mechanism, and knurled head, you can see with this, when you press turn the knurled head, it will press this way, when it will go this way, obviously since there is no other mechanism, but only the internal thread in the clamp bar, external thread on the screw. So obviously relative motion, if the screw is going this way, so this clamp bar will go this way, and in that, due to pivoted action, if this one is going this way, this end will come in this way. So we are achieving 2 points, locking or clamping. Another strap clamps, simply this one is hinge position, take this nut out, simply this whole part you will take out in vertical position, and you can take out in vertical clamp bar or strap vertical position. Then again slide, and then I think I have discussed this one, and you can see the mechanical holding devices, there are hexagonal nut, hand knob, cam handle, and indirect clamping with screw clamp. As you can see, indirect clamping, this part also I have discussed, only you turn the knurl head and it will force the clamp to go this way, clamp bar, and due to pivoted action, this part will come, this end will come this way, and it will lock the workpiece. Again, we have the quick multiple clamps by pivoted clamps. As you can see, number of parts mounted on a surface. So this is the, let me zoom. This one here is a hinge, and then we have this one. Like this arrangement is like this way, so that this head you can put it here and lock it through the washer and nut. So what you have to do, simply take part this out and then see the clamping head, clamping bar. This is the clamping bar. No, not this one. This one. This one. That's your clamping bar, and here you can see one part, two part, three part, four part, five part, six parts. You can lock the various steps, various parts in a one go. And here you have the cylinder head type pin. So that if there is any relative motion due to sliding action, part can be adjusted at right position. So what we are achieving here, we are achieving the locking the many various part. And same thing I will show you with another video. I hope it is visible on your screen. So let me play it. See, this person is having the various parts here and it is mounted on the pallet. Auto mounting. Here you can see four parts. And that on that setup. So what we have seen in the video, only outer side. This is the inside of the clamping. So next is quick clamping by hydraulic and pneumatic forces. So due to pneumatic forces, we can clamp the part. So this part can be has been clamped, as you can see. Not has been clamped, it is a setup to clamp the part. And here again another setup to clamp the part. This one is hydraulic, this is for hydraulic, and this is for pneumatic. Again, light but quick clamping by bayonet type nut clamp. So yeah, we have this part here, and this one is a a groove here on this part. So we will take this down and then we will slide it, so it will fit in the groove. Let's see in next slide how it is fitting. We have this one. This is called bayonet. So first you will take the part or this part clamping device and you will turn it. First you go straight and then turn, swing. So as you can see in this case, again straight, then swing and then lock it. Here it is locked. See, here you can see workpiece is here on this side and clamping end this side. So what you can do, simply you can turn this one and it will, this one is fixed on the machine table, so it will move in this way. And then you will, since it is locking at this position, okay, so first it is to lock it, what you have to do, first this one is at this position so that this end is free. Here this is gap and there is a gap. First this end is here, suppose in that case the groove slot that you can see, it would be here, and this end is here. But as soon as you can, you slide it, so this end goes up to this pin location is here, and then when you swing it, it turns out here and it is locked. And here you lock it in these two position. There is another mechanism, you can lock it. And I will share a video on this, you can watch it later. Then we have the bushes. What are the functions of bushes? As you know, in designing of jigs and fixer, we have to perform the various drilling and milling operation, and due to this and that there is a wear run out of the drill tool, and that causes the defects in part like oversizing, out of roundness and surface roughness that affects. So drill tool usually suffer from run out due to the possible error in drill. There can be run drill, socket and drilling machine spindle, and finally overall alignment. If the drill axis is not aligned with the machine spindle, then we will again have the wear out of the drill bit. So, and again it increases with the drill speed and thrust force. The more we are using it drill tool at higher speed, there is a more or run out. And again, if you are pressing against the work with a high force, then again more tool wear, more tool run out. So what does it do? It affects our product quality. Breakage of the drill by bending, it happens. As you can see, drill bit or tube body, you can see tip, there are different types of drill bit available. So due to this run out, you can see, because it should be there is minimum wear at this end, but due to, as you know, the cutting forces and friction, wear happens. And what happens when you drill it? So you have drill a, for a small distance it is not affecting, but when you drill for deep hole or a small hole, so a small hole having the slender tool, and now suppose we have used a wear out drill bit and for drilling, this type of waviness you can see. And to extend it further, you can observe it only this area, what type of surface we are getting. Not a smooth surface. So surface roughness is another important factor. So we need to avoid first drill tool so that it has the minimum wear and it axis is aligned with the machine. And for that purpose we use washes. So as you can see, there are various types of drill bush. In this one is head. You can see these are the drill bush. So what are the factors we need to consider? While designing jig and bushing, first bushes you properly locate and guide drill. Rimmer CTC generally made of carbon alloy steel. Material is carbon alloy steel and made wear resistance by hardening to Rockwell hardness C scale 60 and above. And often bushes are also made of gray cast iron due to the lesser friction and for protection of the tool. Then hard-ended jig bushes are finished outside by grinding and inside by grinding and lapping if high precision is required. For this, bush length should be sufficient. It means twice the drill diameter. Length we are talking about, we are using a bush length. So we are talking about this height. And its diameter should be slightly larger than the drill diameter. Obvious. Bushes should not come out from the sheet along with the drill turning its return. It means when we have set the drill tool, we are using this bush as a guide, tool guide. So obviously you know it will be used in the jig. Okay. So one requirement, it should not come out with the, when we take out the tool, it should not come out. And then here, well, types of bushes used in jig. There are press fitted type, slip type, screw type. Again, bushes may be classified without head, with head, with flange, with a screw or bracket. As you can see, the bushes are used for the drilling purpose so that your drill axis aligns with the hole axis. And here you can see without head and with head you can see, and then flanged, you can see flange area and where you can lock with the screw. Again, frequently replaceable bushes should be like this. You can easily replace it frequently. These pins are used to lock the bushes so that it does not come out. As you can see here on the flange, it is locking the bushes. And again, we have this special arrangement for two closed holes in one bush and one indexable hole. Indexable means there is some eccentricity. So here we have locking pin, screw pin, and here we need to drill hole. So this one is the indexing. And again here, two closed holes by two adjacent modified bushes, very closed holes, modified bushes we have here. So with this, I have completed this part. And if you have any doubt, you can ask me. I hope You have got the fair understanding.